In the latter half of the 18th century, Hungary's rich cultural life was mainly to be found in the stately homes of local nobility and bishops, where art collections and libraries were established and music ensembles and theatre troupes formed. It was in such palatial homes that opera first found a stage in Hungary. Perhaps the most important of these cultural groups were Bishop Adam Patacsics's theatre players in Nagyvárad, Oradea, Count József Batthyány's orchestra in Pozsony, Bratislava, and an opera company founded by the Counts of Erdőd. Undoubtedly, the most famous venues of the time were the royal residences of the Esterházy family in Kismárton and Esterháza, where recitals and operas were staged under the expert direction of Joseph Haydn. "If I want to hear good opera, I go to Esterháza," is how Empress Maria Theresa praised the world-class opera performances staged by the Esterházy dynasty. The end of the 18th century slowly saw opera become independent of such stately settings, and Hungarian language opera was born. László Kelemen's theatrical players staged the first Hungarian opera in Buda in 1793, which was a work by József Csudi entitled Prince Pikko and Jutka Persi. The score was sadly lost, but the music for Béla's flight survived and first performed in Kolozsvár, Cluj-Napoca in 1822, went on to become the first lasting opera success. As opera moved into the 19th century, Kolozsvár was joined by other provincial centres such as Kassa, Miskolc and Székesfehérvár. A shining star of this period was Róza Derényi Szepataki, who was the first Hungarian Rossina in Rossini's Il Barbiere di Siviglia. The early decades of the 19th century saw Pest Buda become a centre for opera in Hungary. The Rondella in Buda Castle, the castle theatre that hosted Beethoven's performance in Hungary, and the German Theatre of Pest that opened with a Beethoven recital in 1812, all became important venues for musical theatre and ballet. Standing on what is now Vörös Marti Square, the German Theatre of Pest was the largest theatre of its kind in Europe at the time, where opera and ballet were to be seen at their very best. Beyond the German population and state officials, these performances were also largely enjoyed by the Hungarian aristocracy and gentry. Without special permission from the censor, works could only be performed here that had appeared on the Vienna stage on at least two prior occasions. This meant that opera in Pest completely followed the Viennese repertoire, the most popular composers of the period being Rossini and Mozart. After many years of careful planning, the Hungarian Theatre of Pest was eventually opened in the centre of the city opposite the Astoria Hotel, where a modest opera company was directed by Ferenc Erkel. The majority of the performances here were built around Hungary's first internationally recognized opera diva, Rozália Chodelné-Klein, whose famous appearance as Norma saw the wooded retreat outside Budapest given the name Normafa. Bellini and Donizetti operas were performed here to great acclaim, but an expanding repertoire also included Weber's Der Freischutz, Il Barbiere di Siviglia, Fidelio and Don Giovanni. Performed with increasing regularity after 1847, the delightful operas of Verdi soon became cherished favourites of local opera goers. As the popularity of opera increased, the demand for local composers and Hungarian themes grew. The undisputed master of this genre was Ferenc Erkel, who dedicated his life's work to bringing Hungarian history to the opera stage. His first opera, Bátori Mária, had its premiere at the Hungarian Theatre of Pest, which later became the National Theatre. It was also here that the most popular Hungarian opera, Hunyadi László, premiered on the 27th of January, 1844. It was performed an incredible 250 times at the National Theatre alone. Its famous choral work, The Plotter Has Died, becoming the unofficial anthem of the 1848 revolution. Önkéntelen hibátokért szívemből megbocsátok én. Íme halljad, magyar, meghalt a cselszörőben búkorunk száj, korszakunk térjükben lassú nagy király, bűségnek In the aftermath of the 1867 compromise, the capital city and its cultural institutions entered a period of swift expansion. Then in 1874, less than a year after Pest, Buda and Óbuda were brought together to create Budapest, the new municipalities invited architects to tender designs for a new opera house. The eventual winner was Miklós Ebel, whose neo-Renaissance building was considered one of the most modern theatres of the time, with its interior designed and decorated by the very best Hungarian artists, including Mortán, Károly Lotz, Árpád Festi and Bertalan Széke. This ornate hall of music and song was officially opened in the imperial presence of Franz Joseph on the 27th of September 1884. The inaugural performance included the first act from Bánkban, the overture from Hunyadi László, and the first act of Wagner's Lohengrin. The music of Wagner went on to dominate the opera house's repertoire in the early years, and especially during the period between 1888 and 1891, when the great composer and conductor Gustav Mahler held the post of musical director in Budapest. The highlight of Mahler's tenure in Hungary was the opera house premiere of Cavalleria Rusticana during the Christmas of 1890. Pietro Mascagni's one-act opera came to the Budapest stage no more than 6 months after its Italian premiere in Rome and went on to become a firm favorite at the opera house for a quarter of a century. This particular piece still enjoys an enthusiastic welcome, and legend has it that it was Budapest that ensured its place as a standard work for opera companies everywhere. Mascagni's work also introduced verismo to the Budapest opera stage, as lifelike figures of Sicilian peasantry replaced the mythological creations, historical figures, and aristocratic characters to which local audiences had become so accustomed. Verismo operas sought to represent a more earthy interpretation of reality, and Mascagni was joined in his efforts by fellow Italian masters Ruggero Leoncavallo and Giacomo Puccini, who also became great local favorites. Art Nouveau defined musical taste in the early decades of 20th century Hungary, where ebullient, exotic, and often erotic works became extremely popular. It is not surprising, then, that Richard Strauss's Elektra, Salome, and Der Rosenkavalier all saw great success. The Hungarian opera-going public continued to be treated to the mythical and symbolic end of this spectrum by Wagner, while a stronger sense of the decorative, exotic, and vibrant were provided by Puccini. Madame Butterfly caused virtual mass hysteria. Puccini adored Elsa Samoshi, and her death as Cho-Cho-San brought audiences to tears. The Italian virtuoso's visit to Budapest saw him praised by the local press as the greatest composer of the age.
Oh,
Erkel's death saw the genre of the Hungarian historical opera begin to suffer, and although Ernő Dohnányi and Ida Poldini composed a few successful musical works, it was not until Béla Bartók's appearance that the genre was elevated to its highest level. Just as with Bartók's two ballets, his one and only opera, Bluebeard's Castle, premiered at the Opera House in 1918 with its stunning fusion of modern and traditional elements and strong local flavors injected with his unmistakable personal style. The other great composer of the period, Zoltán Kodály, brought the world of Hungarian folk music within the walls of the Opera House with Hári János in 1926 and The Spinning Room in 1932. Kodály's story about a yarn-telling veteran took its inspiration from the fabulous folklore of a bygone age. He strived to write a piece of original folk theatre that embraced the purity of form found only in folk songs. The cellars under the Opera House were used as bomb shelters during the Christmas of 1944, where many members of the company, including Zoltán Kodály, survived the siege of Budapest. Left largely unscathed by the armed battle, work soon recommenced in the Opera House, and its repertoire included a stunning 46 operas by the end of its first successful season. Wagner continued to top the bill, but crowds were similarly drawn to enjoy performances of works by Rossini, Verdi, Puccini, Mozart, and Erkel. The then director, Aladar Tort, and the great German composer, Otto Klemperer, created a true golden age of opera in Budapest with such phenomenal performers as Klára Palánkai, Maria Djurkovic, Imre Ballo, Mihály Csirkei, Sándor Svéd, and Oscar Malecki, who defined the Opera House more than any of their predecessors. It was a time when particular pieces were staged to suit the talent or whim of a star singer, and this is how works such as Donizetti's Don Pasquale went on to enjoy a 1950s renaissance.
Megfogtak téged, be vagy már zárva a kalitkában, mint a madár. Hiába hullatod a csapat könnyeket, hiába sajtozod, én csak nevetek, de már tőled ennek én belelegem, de minden tőlemnek vége már nem lesz, de gondolom a szavak, így fogom, hogy rajta hozzá, hogy a magam, hogy a gyereket mondod, de nem lesz, de madod vele, vagy csódul az igaz. Signor Don Pasquale!
Danke, sir!
Bitte sehr!
Leibos
The years of isolation that followed in the 1950s saw the opera company become a stronghold of exceptional talent, where the established greats were joined by a wealth of new names, including Magda Tisai, Jozef Szymandi, and György Mellis, while Gabriela Lakatos, Viktor Fülöp, and Viktor Rona soon became stars of the ballet stage. The leading lights of the company were primarily those directors, choreographers, and conductors who made outstanding contributions to the artistic merit of life at the opera house over a concerted period of time, such as Gustav Ola and Kalman Nardashti, the choreographer Dula Harangozo, and the house's principal conductor, Janos Ferencik. Ferencik gained an excellent reputation for his sensitive interpretation of works by Bartok and Kodály, but his name is also strongly linked to Alban Berg's Wozzeck and the first appearance on the Budapest stage of Benjamin Britten's opera Peter Grimes. The increasing openness of the 1960s saw international opera stars return to the stages of the opera house and the Urkel Theatre, although such visits were still the exception rather than the rule. Audiences now got to enjoy the singing talents of Mario Del Monaco, Luciano Pavarotti, and Placido Domingo, and renowned conductors such as Lamberto Gardelli, who became a regular guest to Budapest with a series of operas by Verdi. A number of lighter Hungarian operas came to the stage after the Second World War, the most lasting of which was György Ránki's King Pomade's New Clothes. It was composed in the darkest years of the 1950s. His work heavily satirized the cult of personality, using different musical themes to differentiate his characters, including Hungarian folk music, jazz, classic opera, and some ballet scenes. The 1960s was a period in which local composers adopted a style akin to their contemporaries in the West. Two fine examples of this were Emil Petrovich's one-act opera called C'est la guerre in 1962 and Sándor Sokolay's Blood Wedding in 1964. They were also joined by exceptional talents of the time, including István Lang and later János Vajda, Sándor Balassa, Attila Bozai, György Ligeti, Péter Eötvös, as well as József Sári, Levente Dündösi, and Gyula Fekete. The palatial building on Andrássy Avenue is not the only opera venue to have delighted audiences over the last 100 years. Opened in 1911 on what is now Pope John Paul II Square, the People's Opera had a vast auditorium where the opening season ended with the complete Wagner Ring cycle. Between 1911 and 1914, the People's Opera was conducted by Fritz Reiner, whose international career began here with the Budapest premiere of Wagner's Parsifal. During its 100 years of history, the People's Opera hosted performances by Diaghilev's Ballet Russe, the orchestras of La Scala and the Vienna Philharmonic, Arturo Toscanini, Wilhelm Furtwängler, and later even Yves Montand and Gilbert Bécaud. The Opera House took control of the theatre in 1951, and it was subsequently renamed Erkel Theatre in 1953. The outdated building was closed in 2007 and destined to be demolished. Instead, it was marvellously restored in 2011 and continues to operate as a community space and sister theatre to the Opera House.